It's a great pleasure to introduce Kaisa Matomäki, who's going to be talking to us about Singmaster's conjecture in the interior of Pascal's triangle.
Thanks for inviting me. It's a pleasure to speak here. So I talk about Singmaster's conjecture in the interior of Pascal's triangle, and everything is joint work with Maksym Radziwill, Fernando Shao, Terence Tao, and Joni Teräväinen. Okay, so let's start with the basics. So the binomial coefficients n choose k, which are n factorial over k factorial times n minus k factorial. They are quite often arranged as Pascal's triangle, where each entry is the sum of the two previous entries. And if you look at this table, then you see that one seems to appear infinitely often when you continue. But other than that, in 1971, David Singmaster conjectured that one is actually the only number that appears infinitely often in Pascal's triangle. So Singmaster's conjecture says that every integral greater than one appears only a bounded number of times in Pascal's triangle. Or more formally, there exists a positive integral C such that for any t at least 2, the equation t equals n choose m with integrals n and m has at most C solutions. So they sum up a bound for the number of occurrences of any number in Pascal's triangle. And note that there are some sort of trivial coincidences between the numbers in Pascal's triangle by symmetry. So if we have that t equals n choose m, then by symmetry, the left-hand side and right-hand side of the Pascal's triangle looks exactly the same. Then we also have that t equals n choose n minus m. And on the other hand, on the left and on the right, we have just all the numbers next to each other, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So we get the trivial solution t equals t choose 1 and t choose t minus 1. So if we have any t for which t is n choose m, non-trivially, so that m is greater than 1, and also if it's not on the middle, then we already have 4 occurrences of t for trivial reasons. So there are quite a lot of numbers that occur 4 times in Pascal's triangle, anything that appears not on the middle row. And also there are some instances where there are some further non-trivial collisions. In particular, n choose 2 is quite popular to be repeated. It's repeated in 7 occasions. So for instance, 1,540 is 56 choose 2, and it's also 22 choose 3. And actually here we have that for 3,003, there are 3 different solutions on the left of the Pascal's triangle, which yields 8 solutions when using the symmetry and when using the trivial solutions to 3,003 choose 1 and the same thing on the right. And it seems, if you look at the numerics, it seems that actually this 3,003 is the most popular value of binomial coefficient. It has 8 solutions, and it seems that no other number is so popular in Pascal's triangle. So definitely by numerical calculations and looking at the table, it looks like Singmaster's conjecture is right. But in addition to these sort of isolated collisions of n choose 2, there are some more collisions. This is not the whole thing. There is actually an infinite family of collisions. And this was observed independently by Lind, Singmaster, and Tovey around 1970. And they noticed that if you look at the equation n choose m equals to n minus 1 choose m plus 1, so these are 2 things that are quite close to each other in Pascal's triangle, then you can multiply out things like m factorial, n minus 1 factorial, and things like this, and this becomes equivalent to the equation of the hyperbola, 5m plus 4 squared minus 5 times 2n minus 3m minus 2 squared equals minus 4. And one can solve this is a sort of a Bell's equation, and it's soluble, and its solutions are related to the Fibonacci numbers. So this has a solution where n equals the product of 2i plus second and 2i plus third Fibonacci number, and m equals the product of 2i and 2i plus third Fibonacci numbers. So the Fibonacci numbers are, as I usually, are defined as f. The first 2 are ones, and then the next one is the sum of the previous ones. It's sort of an artificial connection, but of course Pascal's triangle is also defined in the way that you get sort of the sum of the two previous entries. It's a bit more complicated, but it's quite similar to Fibonacci sequence. So perhaps it's not a complete surprise that Fibonacci numbers appear when you look at solutions here. And the first instance of this family is actually the 3003, which we already saw. It's 15 over 5 and 14 over 6, which comes from taking I equal to 0 here, I think. And this sort of explains why this 3003 is so popular. It is, by chance, it happens to repeat the something choose 2, as happens every now and then, or as happens in these 7 occasions. And in addition, it happens to belong to this infinite family. So that's why you get sort of 8 solutions for 3003, that it happens to be part of both of these collision families. And so given that there seem to be not many collisions, there is a more precise conjecture. De Wege made a conjecture in 1997 that the above collisions, these isolated repetitions of n choose 2, which were 7 of them, and this infinite family coming from the Fibonacci numbers are actually the only collisions that you have in Pascal's triangle. And of course, this is a conjecture that sort of people like to put their computer to work on and see if they could find some other solution that is not on the list. And there has been work on this. And on the other hand, it's sort of small values of M or something like that makes people to try to prove that well, there can't be at least solutions, the M is 2 or something like that. So they sort of work on sort of doing this for small values of M, N, and D.
So just to make sure that I understand, are you saying that every other number that appears precisely for time, which is not of these shapes?
Except that if it's N choose N over 2, then it appears 3 times.
I see. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, in the middle. Okay, so in particular, it is known that there are no more solutions to ET equals N choose M equals N prime choose M prime in cases when N is at most a million or T a million to 10. And there are no more solutions if M and N prime are very small. If we look at N choose 2 equals N prime choose 3, then we know that there are no more solutions. It's not obvious because you can have N and N prime be very large and there could be solutions, but it has been shown in all of these cases that M and N prime are quite small by various different people. Different cases by different people, but I have just collected all of them here. And furthermore, it's known that if we fix M and N prime, then it's known that there is only a bounded number of solutions to this equation. Again, or even to this equation there. For each fixed T, there's a bounded number of solutions in terms of T, but you also get an absolute bound for the number of solutions of N choose M equals N prime choose M prime. So if one gives, say, M is 10 and M prime is 15, then you know that there's only a bounded number of solutions to this. But this result is ineffective as it's based on Ziegler's theorem on integral points. So when M and M prime grow, also this bounded number of solutions grows. So this doesn't give you Singmaster's conjecture.
So can I ask, what is so special about these tuples, this list of 9 tuples? I didn't quite understand that. 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5, 3, 4, 2, 6, 2, 8, etc. What is so special?
So for this, it has been shown that there is at most this, there are only these collisions and no other collisions. And in these cases, the sort of the equation becomes quite simple because there's on both sides, there's a polynomial of small degree. So it's possible to study the number of solutions.
If, for example, I take 2, 9, would that not work?
Nobody has shown that it works. Yeah.
I see. Because 2, 9 is a rather small tuple.
Yeah, it's rather small, but then I think you have a degree 9 polynomial on one side. So it's not.
So it's still open, basically.
Yeah, I think it's still open, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's make a real life application before going on. So if you're friend says that I made a house of my Lego bricks and I used less than half of the bricks that I have, but of course more than one. And I had this many choices, this many ways in which I could have chosen the bricks from my collection. Then you can immediately figure out where you need a computer. But because this number of choices is smaller than 10 to 60, it's known that the Vegas conjecture holds, and you can figure out that your friend has 54 bricks and the house consists of 26 bricks, because this is the only solution in Pascal's triangle in this region there, at most half on the left side, and having this small team. So here is a picture of the house and the remaining bricks built by my son. Okay, so let's get serious about this conjecture now. Just to make sure we are on the same page, I just say that I use O notations as they use in the analytic number theory. So fx is big O of gx if there's a constant, such that the absolute value of fx is at most c times the gx for all large x. So for instance, on the next slide, I will have a formula like m is at most log t over log 4 plus big O of log log t. So that means that there is a constant c such that m is at most log t over log 4 plus c times log log t. And in this case also m is big O of log t because it's bounded by a constant times log t. But anyway, let's go to seeing rough upper bound for the number of solutions for a given t. So this is already due to Singmaster. When he stated the conjecture, he also gave a rough upper bound for the number of solutions that one can have. Okay, so let's concentrate on the left side by symmetry, that's okay. And so we have a solution t equals n choose m. And if we are on the left side, then n is greater than 2m. And n choose m is greater than 2m choose m. So we move upwards on Pascal's triangle and the numbers get smaller. And by Stirling's formula, it's easy to see that this is about 4 to m over m to half. And taking logs on both sides, we see that m is at most log t over log 4 plus an error term of size log log t. So this error term comes from the m to half and from some constant here. And now if you look at this equation, if t and m are fixed, then n is uniquely determined. If we are in particular on the left side of the Pascal's triangle, t and m uniquely determined m, n, so there can be at most log t solutions because the m has at most of all the log t choices. So this gives a sort of upper bound, but of course the upper bound depends on t, so it's not what Singmaster conjectured. It's a rough thing to add it. And this bound has been improved a few times, most recently by Kane, who showed that the number of solutions is at most log t times log 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 t divided by log log t cubed. So this is a small improvement compared to log t, but it requires quite substantial new ideas to get into smaller. I mean, this simple argument gives you log t, but it requires some work to get into smaller values. And it's by now, nobody knows how to get, say, log t to 1 minus epsilon solutions. And this is also not what we are doing. Okay, so let me tell you what's our result, what we have been working on. So we are not looking at the number of solutions, but instead we concentrate on the sort of the center of Pascal's triangle. So let's fix epsilon, assume that t is large in terms of epsilon. Then our theorem says that there are at most two solutions to n choose m equal to t in the left side of Pascal's triangle if m is not too small, if m is at least x log 2 over 3 plus epsilon n. So we are sort of going into the middle. We don't take the whole Pascal's triangle, but we look at the middle region. But this is quite a big middle region. This is of quite small order, this left side. And note that by the Fibonacci example, this Fibonacci example solutions are in this region here. So this upper bound of at most two solutions is sub. Sometimes there are two solutions in this middle part of Pascal's triangle. And so by symmetry, we get that the utmost four solutions where m is between this exp and n minus this exp. And note just that this exp log 2 over 3 plus epsilon n has size between log n to a and n to epsilon. So it's better than studying m's between n to epsilon and n over 2, but it's worse than having log n to a on the lower bound. And now, thanks to this theorem, if one wants to prove Singmaster's conjecture, one can concentrate on m being between 2 and x log 2 over 3 plus epsilon n, and one doesn't have to worry about this Fibonacci example anymore. Of course, if one looks at Singmaster's conjecture, it says that there's a bounded number of solutions, so you don't have to worry about the and sort of this family, Fibonacci family anyway, but you could sort of hope to prove that there is at most one solution in this remaining area now. And as for what is known previously in the interior of Pascal's triangle, actually not much. Previously, it was known that if m is between n to 5 over 6 and n over 2, then there are at most of order log 3 over 4 to t solutions. So we improve on this in two respects. First, we get a larger range of m, and secondly, we get a much better upper bound for the number of solutions. And previously, it was not known that there's a bounded number of solutions even with m between epsilon n and n over 2. So this sort of gives us a reasonably good range, but unfortunately, it still does solutions one can get because the smallest m is there the sort of the potential for most solution comes from.
So can I ask, maybe I should have asked a few pages earlier, but now actually it later. So I think that if we assume this conjecture, I forgot what's the name, Singmaster. So it kind of using this conjecture, basically we can determine what is the universal number that appears the most in the Pascal's table, right? Triangle, sorry.
So Singmaster's conjecture only says that there is an upper bound for the number of solutions. The Verges conjecture gives the more precise information that 3003 is the most popular.
So basically it does imply that 3003 is the only number that appears 8 times and every other number would appear less than 8 times?
So the Verges conjecture claims this.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
That's what I thought, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No problem. Okay, so let's discuss the proof of our theorem. So there are two steps. I first give them sort of informally and then I give them more precise formulation. So let's concentrate on the left side of the Pascal's triangle. And the first step is that we show that if there are two solutions, n t equals n choose m and t equals n prime choose m prime, then m and n prime must be close to each other and also n and n prime must be close to each other. So these two solutions can't be too far away in the Pascal's triangle. And the second step is we saw that if we are given a solution t equals n to m, then there can be at most one other solution for which m prime is close to m and n prime is close to n. And combining these two steps together shows us that there can be at most two solutions because the first step shows that all the solutions must be close to each other. And the second step shows that there can be at most two solutions that are close to each other. Okay, so let me formulate this more precisely. So first step, that if there are two solutions, then they must be close to each other. So if we have that t equals n choose m and n prime choose m prime, then what we can show is that m prime and m have difference at most this exp log 2 over 3 plus epsilon n plus n prime. And on the other hand, if we are on this so this holds always, but if we are on this interior region we are interested in, if m and m prime are of size at least exp log 2 over 3 plus epsilon n, then we also can show that the difference of n and n prime is at most all of order exp log 2 over 3 plus epsilon n plus n prime. So this is the step one. If we have two solutions, then both m and n prime must be close to each other and n and n prime must be close to each other. And for the step two, more formally, we saw that if we have that equals n prime to n prime, for which n prime and m have difference at most x pure log b to 1 minus epsilon, and n prime and n have difference at most x pure log b to 1 minus epsilon. These are now written in a bit different terms, these steps 1 and 2, because this is in terms of size of t, which is much greater than the size of n, and these are in terms of size of n. But doing some bookkeeping and looking at this, it turns out that these two things together do imply that there are at most two solutions, because this shows that all the solutions have small differences, and this shows that, well, there is at most two solutions that are close to each other. Okay, so let's discuss how we actually can prove these steps. So let's start with the step one, and let's start with the weaker and simpler result than the actual what we proved. So a result that just gives us this sort of the qualitative form of step one. So we saw that if there are two solutions, t equals n to m and n prime to n prime, then these m and n prime are close to each other, and n prime are close to each other. So at this point, they are not this close as we want, but they are somewhat close. This sort of gives us some assurance that this makes sense. Okay, so let's do this. So let's start with the definition of binomial coefficient. It's n choose n factorial divided by n factorial n minus m factorial. And if we sort of cancel this n minus m factorial from both denominator and numerator, then we end up with having on the top, we have the product from integers from n to n minus m plus 1. And on the bottom, we have product of integers from m to 1. And note that if we are on the left side of Pascal's triangle, m is at most n over 2, then these numbers are different. There's not same numbers appearing. N minus m plus 1 is greater than m. And thus, if we look at this number, then it must be divisible by all the primes that appear on the top. So if some of these numbers are primes, then the binomial coefficients are divisible by that prime, because the same numbers don't appear in the denominator. And on the other hand, it can't be divisible by any prime larger than n, because there is no number larger than n appearing on the product. And in particular, if we have that t equals n to m, and if this interval, if there is a prime on the top, if the interval from n minus m plus 1 to n contains a prime, then the greatest prime factor of t must equal the greatest prime factor, the greatest prime in this interval from n minus m plus 1 to n. And now, by work of Baker, Harman, and Pinch, we do know that there's a prime in the interval from n minus n to 0.525 to n for all large n. And so if we have that t equals n choose m, and if m is between n to 0.525 and n over 2, then we know that if m is larger than this n 0.525 here, then we know that this interval, which means that the greatest prime factor of t is the greatest prime in this interval. So if we have t with m in this range, then the greatest prime factor of t is the greatest prime factor in this interval, and in particular, the greatest prime factor of t does belong to this interval from n minus n to 0.525 to n. And on the other hand, if we also have that t equals n prime choose n prime, with n prime in a similar range from n prime to 0.525 to n prime over 2, then by the same argument, we know that the greatest prime factor of t belongs to n prime minus n prime to 0.525 to n prime. And of course, the greatest prime factor, there's only one greatest prime factor of t. It's a unique number, and it belongs to both of these intervals. So these intervals must intersect. And if these two intervals here, n minus n to 0.525 to n, and n prime minus n prime to 0.525 n prime, if they intersect, this means that the n and n prime must have distance at most n plus n prime to 0.525. So we obtained that if t equals n to m and n prime to n prime to n prime, with m and n prime from not too small, from n to 0.525 to n over 2, then we have an upper bound for n minus n prime, and also we get an upper bound for m minus n prime similarly, but that we don't need it, you know, for this discussion. So we got the result in the sort of what we wanted. We wanted to show that N and N prime must be close to each other, and we got that, but not as close as we wanted. I mean, for our step one in the formal terms, we actually wanted that M prime is like of size X proc 2 over 3 plus epsilon N plus N prime, and we wanted that N prime minus N is of size X proc 2 over 3 plus N plus N prime, and we wanted M and M prime to have a larger range than just coming from this interval, but we wanted that they are allowed to come from a larger interval. So we want some significantly stronger bounds. But already this simple argument does give us step one in sort of a small interior region of Pascal triangle. It's sufficient for this, but it's not sufficient for that. We are heading for a much, much larger interior region, but in the very middle, it does work. And why this sort of the simple argument doesn't work is basically due to that we don't know too much about primes in short intervals. If one sort of uses Kramer's model, then one expects that intervals of length about log n squared always contain primes. And then under this assumption, we would get a similar result with log n to 2 plus epsilon, say here, and which is stronger than what we get. But of course, nobody knows. We are nowhere close to showing that intervals of length log n squared contain primes. It's just a contour. If one assumes Riemann hypothesis, we can just replace this 0.525 here by half plus epsilon. So even Riemann hypothesis doesn't give us anything like this. Okay. But so there's some more work to do about step one. This simple argument is not sufficient. And to do this work, I will quite sort of just wave my hands about how to do this step, but I will say a few things about it. So we've write new Pn for the periodic valuation of n, which basically is the k for which p to k exactly divides n. So it's the greatest integral k such that p to k divides n. And then if you look at the periodic evaluation of n factorial, it can be written as the sum of n over p to j flow functions. So this tells us how many times for j equal to 1, it tells us how many times we have a p dividing n factorial and then p squared dividing n factorial and so on. So we get a nice formula for this. And then we can use the periodic equation, which is then the sum of n over p to j flow minus m over p to j flow minus n minus m divided by p to j flow. And here we write parenthesis x for the fractional part of x, so that the x is the flow function of x plus the fractional part of x, and plugging this in that the flow function of x is x minus the fractional part. If you put it in here, then the sort of the x's disappear, because here we have n minus m minus n minus m. So they disappear and we are left with the fractional parts. So we get then this periodic evaluation of n choose m is this sort of sum where we have sums of different fractional parts. Okay, so this is just again what we had on the previous slide. And now if we have two solutions, if t equals both n choose m and n prime choose m prime, then of course also the periodic valuations of n choose m and n prime choose m prime must equal for every prime p. So in this case, if we have a solution, then we get that for every prime p, we have this equality here. And let me say that this left-hand side here sort of counts the number of carries one has to make when one adds m and n minus m modulo in the base p to j. But that's not really relevant here, but one can sort of think of it as this way. And now we have quite a lot of information about what is happening, because this holds for every prime p, and there are a lot of primes. So one could hope that one can show some sort of contradiction from the fact that this should hold for every can be. And but there are some issues. So it's, for instance, if M is small, then we probably want to take P to be small as well, and then there are a lot of chase contributing. On the other hand, if M and M prime or some others are some sort of commensurable, there is some sort of conspiracy going on in these things. But to come around such issues, we study random P and we study various covariances of the fractional parts. We take covariances of both sides with, say, the fractional part of N over P and fractional part of M over P and so on. And this sort of allows us to show that actually this cannot happen unless M is close to M prime and N is close to N prime. And to study the covariances, we use an equidistribution result concerning these fractional parts. So the equidistribution result says that if we sum over primes P in some interval, which is not, well, the primes are not too small compared to N and M, then we get that the fractional parts of N over P and M over P to J are distributed as they should according to the prime number theorem. So in the same way that if instead of summing over primes, we integrated over everything with taking into account the density of the primes. This sort of says that the distribution of the fractional parts is as it should be. And for the proof of this lemma, we do a standard thing. We make a Fourier expansion on the left-hand side, and this reduces us to studying exponential sums over primes, where we have e to 2 pi I n over p plus m over p to j coming from this fractional part here. So we Fourier expand both of these. And of course, they get sort of coefficients k times n over p and l times m over p to j here when we make the Fourier expansion. But by redefining n and m, we get this. This is the form of the exponential sums we get. And such sums can be handled using Vinogradov's exponential sum estimate. So these are the general estimates that helps one to estimate sums or the exponential sums over some smooth functions Tn, and also exponential sums over smooth functions T with exponential sum running over primes. And this, eventually using this, we obtain the desired result by using this equality at every prime, and then looking at the covariances, and then using this equidistribution result, we do get the upper bounds for M prime minus M and N prime minus N as we wanted. And the reason why we get this X log 2 over 3 plus epsilon appearing here and here and here, it comes from the Vinogradov-like exponential sum estimates. So here in the lemma, we had to have that M and N are at most of size X log 3 over 2 minus epsilon P. And this comes from the permutation in Vinogradov exponential sum. This same sort of limitation appears when you prove, say, a zero free region for the Riemann set of function. We get similar things in the exponential sums happening. And unfortunately, even if we assume Riemann hypothesis, it's not clear to us how to improve on this range here. So in the case of the zero free region of the Riemann zeta function, of course, if you assume Riemann hypothesis, you get a nice zero free region. But here we don't see how to use Riemann hypothesis to improve this. Okay, so this sort of limits here what we can do. It's we would either need very good exponential sum estimates, or we would need to know what about primes in short intervals or something quite strong in order to improve on our bounds. But this gives us the step one. And then we can move on to step two, which was saying that if t equals n plus m, then there is at most one other solution which is close to this, for which m prime is close to m and n prime is close to n. And to so this, we use Kane's Archimedean analysis. So Kane, as I said before, proved a better upper bound for the number of solutions, then Singmaster had here this log t log t divided by log t cubed for the number of solutions, and we use similar argument in order to deduce this thing here as Kane used in his proof. And in order to do this, we take the equation t equals n plus m, and we generalize it to real numbers, to real m from 1 to n over 2 by writing t as the gamma n plus 1 divided by gamma n plus 1 and gamma n minus m plus 1. So of course, gamma n plus 1, for instance, is n factorial. So for the integers, this is the same thing as n plus m, but now we can study this as a function of a real variables n and m. And now if we fix t and m, then the right-hand side is increasing as a function of n if we are on this range. Yeah. And so the binomial quotient grow when you go down the triangle, basically. And this gets us to, by the inverse function theorem, we can define f sub tm to be the unique solution n to this equation. So given an m and given a t, we write ftm for the n that solves this equation. So usually it's a real number, usually it's not an integer, but it's a real function. Ftm is the unique solution n to this equation here. And now solving this n choose m equals to t for integers n and m corresponds to finding lattice points m ftm. So if this solution n ftm is an integer, then we get the solutions to n choose m equals to t. And now this ftm is a real function, and one can study its size and so on by looking at this and using Stirling's formula and stuff like this. And one can show that it has ftm for given m and t, the n giving the solution here has size m times t to 1 over m. And also one can study the derivatives. For us, the most important thing is the second derivative. So that's why I'm writing down the size of the second derivative here. And next I will introduce a general lemma that gives us an upper bound for the number of lattice points one can have on such a real curve where we know something about the second derivative. Okay. Okay, so this is just a very general lemma. So let I be an interval and let f from I to r be a smooth function for which we have know that the second derivative doesn't vanish. And on the other hand, we have an upper bound for it. Or it's the upper bound is twice the length of the interval cubed. And let's also assume that the second derivative satisfies this for all x. And then the lemma says that there are at most two integers m for which fm is also an integer. So there are at most two lattice points on the curve m, fm in this case. And the proof is pretty short, so I will go through it. So let's suppose that there are three lattice points. Let's suppose that there are three distinct integers in this interval I for which also fmj is an integer. And now let's define a polynomial Px by sort of the Lagrange interpolation theorem. So this is a polynomial of degree at most two, which equals fmj, at least mj. So there are three points, and we can cook up a polynomial which goes through these three points. And the polynomial looks like this. So if you plug in, say, m1 here, you notice that this thing, this product disappears for everything but I equals to one. And then in that case, one gets fm1 from here. Okay, so this is a polynomial of degree at most two, and it coincides with the function f at these three points. And now this difference of f and p is zero at three different points in the interval. And by, I think, two applications of Rogge's theorem, one can show that there must be a zero of the second derivative of the function, because it has two zeros on the interval. There must be some zero of the second derivative in the interval. So we can find some x star from the interval such that f, the second derivative of f equals the second derivative of p. And so by the definition, we see that if we look at the second derivative of p divided by 2, then that's the constant term of the polynomial. And so it's a constant. And also, if we look at this formula here, we notice that it must be an integer multiple of the product of the denominators. If you look at this definition of px and you take the second derivative, then certainly at an integer point, it must be an integer multiple of this mi minus m j's here. So it's the, because it's the constant term of the polynomial, it must be an integer multiple of this, the product of mi minus m j's. And since these mi's and m j's come from an interval of length I, an integer multiple of it is of size 1 over the length of the interval to cubed, or it's a 0. But we had this assumption that the second derivative divided by 2 is between 0 and the length of the interval to minus 3. So we get the contradiction with this assumption here. So this sort of shows us that if we have a smooth function whose second derivative is not 0, but it's very small, then there can't be too many integer points. There's just simply no space for them. And so now we can get into solving the step 2. We had that this solving this equation n choose m equals t corresponds to finding lattice points in this curve m ftm. And we had that the second derivative of ftm had this sort of size, mt to 1 over m times log t over m squared to squared. And we had this lemma showing that if we have that the second derivative is non-zero but bounded by the length of the interval to minus 3, then we know that there are at most 2 integer points. And combining these 2 things, we can show that there are at most 2 solutions with m prime minus m and n prime minus n being of size x log t to 1 minus epsilon. So just combining these 2 things, we just have to choose the interval length. Well, we choose it to be something like this. And then it turns out that the second derivative here is smaller than the 1 over the interval length cubed. And then this lemma gives that there are at most 2 integers in this range. So this finishes step 2. And so we have done. We are basically done. We have shown first step. We saw that if there are 2 solutions, t equal n choose m and n prime choose m prime, then these m and n prime are close to each other and n and n prime are close to each other. And in the step 2, we showed that there can be at most 2 solutions where m and n prime are close to each other and n and n prime are close to each other. So combining these, we get our theorem, which said that in the interior of Pascal's triangle, there are at most sort of 2 solutions to n choose m equaling t. And as I said before, this is sharp in the sense that there is this Fibonacci solution. Of course, it's they are quite rare, these Fibonacci solutions, but sometimes there are indeed 2 solutions in this region. But this sort of doesn't quite give you the Weigel's conjecture in the interior of Pascal's triangle, because we can't sort of say that when the Fibonacci solution appear and when not, but this does give the Singmaster conjecture in the interior with a very good bound that there are at most 2 solutions. Okay, and one can use similar methods to treat some other sort of similar equations, so some sort of factorial Diophantine equation. So for instance, what we did in the paper 2 is the Fogging factorial equation. So we sort of don't take the division by m factorial appearing in the binomial coefficient, but we just look at the product of m consecutive numbers. We look at products of m consecutive numbers, and we study these following factorials. And we can show similar result for this. So if these sufficiently large, we can show that there are at most two integer solutions in the where this M is not too small, where we don't sort of have a very short product, but instead we have a pretty long product where this M is pretty large. No, not too small, rather than pretty large. Then we can show that there are at most two integer solutions, and the techniques are exactly the same, but unfortunately the details are a bit different, so we had to redo about everything in order to do this case as well. And I guess one can cook up other equations where you can use similar methods, then they have some sort of shape like this. Okay, well, that's all I wanted to say. Thanks.